Dr. Sheila Nambiar. I think a lot of the viewers already know her because a lot of them, I can see them from ISLM, and also a lot of my clients also knows you very well. She's a medical practitioner, fitness and lifestyle consultant, an author and a speaker. She's currently practicing gynecology in Ooty and provides counseling, guidance, motivation and solutions for lifestyle change. I think this is not new because, you know, like 10 years back when I was having my baby, I was just searching randomly for fitness doctors, you know, like somebody. So I came across your TED video.
Okay. You know, that okay.
We were not very close to each other or something, but I was yes. very impressed. Age-defying look. Okay. The holistic training for life program founded by Dr. Sheila Nambiar teaches women the science of fitness, food and lifestyle. She has three best-selling books in her name. She's the author of three best-selling books. And she also writes columns in magazines, online forums and newspapers regularly. And I think you also know, she is actually the president of Indian Society of Lifestyle Medicine. She actually is one of my mentor in the field mm-hmm. and great inspiration for me. I keep telling her in all the forums which we went
after. Thank you, Regina.
She has authored three best-selling books that I've already mentioned. I think some of the books we will share the images during the presentation itself. She also addresses her teachings at various platforms, including corporates, organizations, clubs, associations, and also recently seen many of her programs in medical seminars or webinars.
Society.
Yes, medical society. I was just so thrilled and honored to be sharing this virtual platform with her today. Dr. Nambiar, thank you so much for joining us today.
Thank you, Regina. Thank you so much.
You get enough time to...
And you've chosen a wonderful topic.
Thank you.
Mindfulness, yeah. Much needed.
Yeah. That's what actually a lot of people commented actually. When I shared the meeting details with them, you know, this is the need of the hour. Many of them.
Yeah.
So it's over to you, actually, Dr. Sheila. You can start with maybe if you want to have a punchline, we can start, or otherwise I'll directly go to the questions.
You can directly go to the questions, and then in between we can, you know, chat if questions are not there.
Okay. This is a very relevant question because when I started this practice in 2014 or so, you know, like, my own experience and my family's experience has helped me to kind of shift the field. But recently, like when I started having a lot of clients, what I've noticed is a lot of them require some kind of a cognitive behavioral therapy or a kind of mind shiftness or restructuring their thoughts to become efficient in all walks of life, even if you are a homemaker, to be healthy and happy and satisfying, to lead a satisfying life. You need to have some level of restructuring. That's what I've noticed. But then what I've kind of collaborated with many of these people who are doing pranayama and all. Some of them are doing wonderful job like Deepa and all. But I feel that in our society, the concept of mindfulness is not very clear. It is very much restricted to pranayama or some practices. It's not really understood in a global way or with the proper picture of science, actually. If you can explain that. Would be the first thing to start off.
Yeah. No, you're right. I think most people consider mindfulness to be separate from their life.
Exactly.
You know, to be something that they have to practice separate from their day-to-day living, which is actually not the case. The reason you practice things like mindfulness meditation is just so that it permeates the rest of your life. So if you ask for a definition of mindfulness, I would say mindfulness is nothing but conscious living. That's all it is, which means that you are conscious of what you're doing in your present state. You're conscious and aware of your thoughts, and you're also conscious and aware that your thoughts are just your thoughts and separate from you. They are not you. They can be generated spontaneously in your brain. And at any given time, you have hundreds of thoughts flitting through your brain. I always, you know, give this analogy of imagine you're sitting on a railway platform and you're watching the trains go by. and you watch the speed of the trains, the color of the trains, the direction in which they are going. It's compare that, imagine that those trains are your thoughts, and you are sitting on the platform and observing those thoughts. So if you get on one of those trains, you become a part of your thoughts. You become very involved with your thoughts. You become almost like you are your thoughts. But even in that case, you know that we can, you know, by pulling a lever, you can actually change the track of your tracks on the train. So in a similar way, you can actually change the trajectory of your thoughts. So your thoughts can be controlled by you, in other words. So when we talk about mindfulness, it actually is, or rather it should be present in every walk of life. You should be eating mindfully, you should be exercising mindfully, you should be living mindfully, you should be bathing mindfully. Every aspect of your life needs to be mindful. It's not always possible. I understand we're all distracted. We're doing 10 different things. So sometimes when you are sitting and eating, you're thinking about something else. When you are working on your project, you're thinking of your meal. Sometimes when you're exercising, you're thinking of something else. You're thinking about what you're going to eat for lunch. So that kind of a distracted approach to activity is mindlessness. So that's really the opposite of mindfulness. So basically, when you define mindfulness, it's nothing but conscious living, living in the present moment, being aware of the present moment. And to add to that, it needs to be done without judgment, which means that you don't constantly second guess yourself and start feeling anxious and agitated about the thoughts that you're having. You're just present. You're observing your thoughts, like an onlooker almost. And you also are aware that you can change the direction and the trajectory of your thoughts. And you don't judge your thoughts. You don't judge yourself, which is a way of being compassionate to oneself as well. So mindfulness actually, if you project mindfulness, it's actually a way of being, of practicing self-compassion as well, which is also, I believe, extremely important in today's world. We do so many things, and the last 1.5 years has been extremely stressful for everybody. So there's been a lot of anxiety, there's been fear, which is quite understandable given the circumstances. But even in situations like this, living mindfully in the present moment, understanding that in any given moment, in any given situation, there is something that you perhaps have control over, and there is something or many things that you don't have control over. So dwelling on and getting anxious about the things that you don't have control over is really a waste of time and is a waste of your energy. So we need to focus on the things that we have control over. Do it mindfully. Do whatever we are doing, do it mindfully.
Excellent, actually. This kind of explains the whole thing. Basically, people actually, there are a few of our clients who say that in spite of multiple trainings, I'm not able to do mindfulness. So actually, they kind of confuse mindfulness with meditation, where you have to sit at one place and trying to, channelize, cut your thoughts and things like this. This is wonderful, actually. I also wanted to tell a short, this thing experience about me. My mindfulness is basically gardening. Okay, I love when I do gardening, I just forget about everything. I'm in that moment.
You get into flow.
Yes, yeah, I get into the flow. I also like something, reading about something which is engaging. I am a science person, so I love science. Anything related to that just gives the thinking or thought process that actually is mindfulness. I do
Yes,
my
yes.
meditation, which is also a form of, trying to be present with the thing, that I do every day. These are the things I also learned it from lifestyle medicine experiences.
Yeah.
What activities lead to mindfulness?
So it's not an activity that leads to mindfulness. It should be mindfulness is in every activity. So when you want to improve mindfulness, what do? You do mindfulness meditation, you do mindfulness exercises. The only thing that mindfulness meditation actually teaches you is that you can bring your thoughts back to to whatever it is that you want to focus on. So for instance, if you do a breathing meditation, the practice involves just following your breath, just watching your breath, even if it's for 5 minutes or 10 minutes, you close your eyes and watch your breath. And in those 5 minutes, your mind will probably wander to several things while you're trying to just watch your breath. And the process of bringing your mind gently back to your breath, that is the exercise. So many people say, you know, I failed in my mindfulness meditation because my mind is getting distracted and it's wandering around. It's wandering all over the place. But in reality, the exercise is really the act of bringing the thoughts back to your breath. So it's like doing a bicep curl. You know, when you do the bicep curl, that is the act exercise. So similarly, the action of bringing the mind back to your breath is the act of mindfulness. And that can permeate to the rest of your day. In other words, what I mean is you become conscious through the rest of your day that your thought process is going on side by side, that you have a self-talk, a conversation going on in your head, even while you're doing something. You become aware of that. And when you become aware of that, you're able to change it. Let's say you're not aware of this conversation that's going on in your head. Let's say you're not aware of the thoughts that are going on in your head. It's very unlikely you can change it. So let me give you an example. For instance, you know, people who have, and you have clients who want to lose weight, Regina. So, you know, they probably start, you know, they start with really good intentions. They follow the diet. They follow all the recommendations. And then one day they slip or they have something that's tempting and they indulge. And if they stop and watch or listen to the thoughts that are actually going through their head, they may observe several kind of thoughts. For instance, they may be telling themselves, oh my God, how could I have done this? I'm such a bad person. I'm such a failure. I shouldn't have eaten this. And then with that thought, there is guilt and there is shame, right? So they are judging themselves. And that the thoughts that are going through their head are not necessarily productive thoughts. So as a result of these thoughts, what would be the next thought? They would say something like, I've done this one meal, so let me just forget about the rest of the day. Let me just eat badly the rest of the day or maybe the rest of the week. And then they just fall off the wagon completely. Instead, if they stop and if they eat whatever it is that they've indulged in, watch their thoughts, understand that they're being self-critical, understand that they're feeling guilt, they're feeling shame as a result of that self-critical thought, then they can stop themselves in their tracks right there after that one meal and say, let me get back on the wagon. I don't need to feel guilt and shame. I have a right to indulge sometimes. I'm not a bad person because I have eaten something that I'm not supposed to eat. It's not a moral judgment, right? So a lot of times I find this is especially related to weight and related to weight loss. There is morality that is, mixed with this, where they start judging themselves for being quote unquote bad people, not being able to succeed. And all of that is a result of their own self-talk. So if they just listen to their self-talk, listen to their thoughts and be mindful of just the present moment, they would be able to change the trajectory of their success. They change the trajectory of how they proceed with either following the diet, continuing to exercise, continuing to lead healthy, or not doing so because they're just so overwhelmed with all these these thoughts and this judgment and all of that comes into their mind. So that is what mindfulness does for you on a day-to-day basis. This 10-minute meditation that you may practice perhaps once in the morning, maybe once again in the evening, what it does is it enables you to get a hold and understand your thoughts and understand yourself better during the course of the day. It just helps you get more mindful during the course of the day.
Excellent. So that was the next question. Basically, this mindfulness kind of help you, aware about your thoughts, you know, just giving a light that, you know, these are the thoughts going on. Normally, we do not actually pay attention. Yeah. Actually, yes. I I have a few clients actually, you know, who are in a weight loss journey or diabetic reversal, multiple conditions. So some of them have really, you know, they're really struggling with these thoughts actually, you know, like, you know, there are people from outside India at middle of the night, 10:30, they ask whether they can have a session, you know, those kind of things actually, you know, like after repeatedly giving sessions also, you know, like there are psychiatric medications also needed in some cases, you know, some it may need it, you know, later you can wean it off with mindfulness and those practices.
I just like to say there, Regina, that, you know, mindfulness practices, counseling, all of those are, they are extremely useful, but sometimes patients who, they may, like you said, require psychiatric help, even while they are getting the psychiatric help, I would advise them to use these tools such as mindfulness meditation and other mindfulness practices, exercise, clean eating, all these tools. These are just tools, and they should be used in conjunction with any other medical management, whether it is psychiatric management, whether it is diabetes, whether it is weight loss, whatever it is. These are all tools that you need to use in conjunction with whatever the main treatment is.
That is the funda. If the physician decides that you need to be on tablets, please do not just trust the intent and then go ahead with it. Actually, you know, like, we are all lifestyle physicians. We try to take you off medications as much as possible. In certain cases, it may not be possible. And, you know, as Dr. Sheila said, actually, that is the idea of having these sessions, paying attention to those tools to keep you healthy so that you don't have to taking 5-6 pills when you're turning 50 or 60. Actually, there is a question by one of our project trainees. I think this is like with a lot of youngsters which we come across. He's saying, actually, like, not about him, I'm just saying a generalized trend in youngsters. What they do is, you know, they feel that, okay, daytime and everybody is around, you know, a lot of distractions are there, not very productive, they're not very creative, their intellect doesn't work. But after 10 o'clock is the time they work, and they keep working till 3-4. And they feel that they're very productive during that time, but the whole day actually is gone. So that is one aspect of the story. So Rishabh's question is, actually, Rishabh is again a project trainee. Ma'am, if my creativity stems from my mind lingering on random thoughts,
yes, will mindfulness inhibit my... No, not at all. Not at all. In fact, mindfulness will definitely increase your creativity, because all mindfulness is doing is becoming aware of your thoughts. It's not stopping your thoughts. It's not about judging your thoughts. It's just becoming aware of your thoughts. So you can become more aware of those creative thoughts. You will be able to tap into those creative thoughts much better if you practice mindfulness. So mindfulness does not in any way impede creativity. That's a very false misconception. In fact, I would think it would improve creativity. And for creative people, it is definitely something that they need to do. Often also, I find, you know, Regina, that these creative people and people who are, you know, not following a very regular kind of a profession like you and me, they do talk about these creative thoughts and all of that. But you see, they also need to have structure in their lives. They also need to do things that they are responsible for, like taking care of their own health, taking care of the people who are dependent on them. Now, all of that requires mindfulness. You can't always walk around with, you know, your head in the clouds, thinking random thoughts, right? That's fine. But you do have a responsibility towards yourself and towards other people as well. And that's where mindfulness helps. So Rishabh, I hope that answered your question. If you can practice mindfulness and then get back to us and tell us if it has helped you, it would help everybody else as well.
I also wanted to add to maybe a 2 minutes point there. Actually, it's regarding one of those researches done by one of my favorite cognitive neuroscientists. I forgot his name, but right now. But what he has done is, it's Harvard medical students. I think Harvard medical students, has done an experiment where the creativity becomes maximum. You know, that is about creativity. So like, so what he was saying is, when are we having some ideation, you know, the first idea later, there are a lot of neurons keep firing, and it'll be like a confused state. Okay, too many neurons firing. So there should be some level of suppressing the brain to a level so that
direction. Yes.
And one of the was actually, even alcoholism, some of this, that's not bad, that's bad. But that is one of the things which was suppressing the brain, but in a bad way, right? Yeah. Whereas mindfulness is, once you're aware of your thoughts, you can actually start pursuing thoughts which is more valid at that moment in time.
Yes.
The meta thinking about that thinking. That
thinking
becomes,
about our thoughts. Yes.
That becomes more. Actually, so these are some of the tools even I practice, Doc, actually, because I feel sometimes too many thoughts comes, you're not very sure whether that thought is something which is going to be really value adding to whatever service you're providing. So this meta thinking structure helps, and mindfulness helps a great deal in it.
Yes, absolutely.
Thank you, Doc. With the busy lifestyle, how does one make time for mindfulness and activities leading to mindfulness?
Okay, so everybody has, and I say this all the time, everyone has 24 hours in a day. Nobody has more or less. So in the 24 hours, it's all a question of priority. All it takes is literally 10 minutes of mindfulness meditation every day. And then you need to include an hour of exercise, and then you need to set aside time for your food. You need to do that. It's non-negotiable. So the minute you start understanding that these things are non-negotiable, you will prioritize them. You know, when you sit down and you actually look at the number of hours that, you write down, wake up at whatever, 5 o'clock, and then what do you do from 5 to 5:30, and then from 5:30 to 6:30, and you actually write down the number of things that you do, you will be surprised at the amount of time we waste, what we call as time wasters, where you're just basically doing nothing. It is important to do a bit of daydreaming and do nothing through the day. That's important too. But many times, many of those time slots we can allot to a 10-minute mindfulness practice, or you can allot it to a 10-minute exercise. We know that 3 10-minute segments is as good as 1 30-minute segment. So this whole concept of I don't have time, I think it all goes back to time management. And honestly, Regina, from my experience, I found that the busiest people are the ones that really make the time. The ones who are less busy somehow don't seem to have the time.
Yeah, that is actually maybe those people kind of worked on themselves, this restructuring happened. It's actually everybody can do this restructure. It's actually the, awareness, and maybe sometimes you may have to take support. But otherwise, there are a lot of resources available. Try with that. If it's not happening, structured support is required. Dr. Sheila herself does counseling. You can always get in touch with her. And another one is another client of mine, Grishma. These people are some of those patron clients. I do know she has kind of come a long way from diabetic management, really doing well. But this is her doubt. I find myself arguing myself in my mind when something happens in my life. Any tricks to stop that? Is this like
arguing with yourself in your mind is questioning or second guessing yourself? Is that what you're asking? Or do you, by arguing, are you presenting yourself with both sides of the argument? In which case, that's great.
Yeah.
So if you are able to present to yourself both sides of the argument, that's actually a good thing. But if you're just constantly second guessing yourself, where you want to make a decision and then you're doubtful about the decision and you're going back on the decision, you're going back and forth, that's where you may need help. You may need to talk to somebody about about actual situations and circumstances. See, that's a very general question. So it would be difficult to give a very specific answer. But if you, let us say, go to a therapist or a counselor and present them with specific situations where you say, for instance, this is what happened and this is what I thought, and then this is what I thought again and went back on my thoughts, they would be able to help you with that. So that goes into cognitive behavioral therapy as well, where your behavior is different. depends upon the thoughts, which is what cognitive behavioral therapy is based on. So like I said, if you're presenting yourself with both sides of the argument, that I would think is a good thing. But if your mind is just going around in loops, then you might require some amount of help from a professional.
Excellent. So basically, also just good to have those kind of meta thinking and analysis of what is going on, what thinking about thinking happening. But if it is going on a loop and not able to take any
decisions, yes,
it's high time you take because it doesn't lead to any constructive actions, and you will end up having a lot of depressive negative symptoms. Am I correct, Doc?
Yes. Wow. Sorry, I lost you there, Regina. What did you say?
Recollecting what you said. You said that like a constructive thing going on and which is helping you to take better decisions, it's good.
If it is like a
loop and you're not able to take decisions and you are actually stuck at that and getting into thoughts, depressive symptoms, it's time to take that.
Absolutely, absolutely, yes.
Why is mindfulness analogous to medicine? We call it mindfulness is medicine.
Yes. If you think about it, every aspect, everything that we do to improve our health, for instance, exercise or eating healthy, all of this requires mindfulness. And without practicing mindfulness in these activities, in these simple things, day-to-day life, like your exercise, your work, your eating, if you're mindless in these activities, that's where the problem really starts. So let's take eating, for instance. I don't know if many people know that most people just think that they are eating because maybe they are hungry, or they want to eat, or they need to eat. Do they stop and question themselves about just observe what is the real thought going through their mind? Is it boredom? Is it anxiety? Is it depression? So when you stop and ask yourself this, or observe the emotion and the thought that's going through your mind, you may recognize that you're not really hungry, you know? And it's not just the thought in your mind, it's also the signals that your body is sending you. For instance, if you are not really hungry, your body is going to tell you you're not really hungry. But very often we overrun that, we overrule that feeling of satiety, and we will go and we may pick up something like a snack. We must be aware that eating, unfortunately, in an ideal world, eating should be controlled by satiety and hunger. But we don't live in an ideal world. There are a lot of external cues that influence eating. So did you know that even the lighting in the room, the color on the walls, the music that is being played, the number of people around you, the size of your plate or your bowl, all of these influence how much you eat? So we are not aware of these things. We just do it. If you go into a fast food restaurant, you'll see bright colored walls. It'll be noisy. And the food served is in large quantities. Whereas if you go to a much more upmarket fine dining restaurant, the music is muted. The walls are, dull, muted, and it's quiet. And you get minute quantities of food. You will still feel quite satiated eating that food because of the ambience that has been created. Right. So everything around you also influences how much you eat. You may be knowing this Dr. Brian Wozniak, who does a lot of experimentation on mindfulness and mindful eating. And there's this famous popcorn experiment where people going into the theater, half of them were given stale popcorn, half of them were given fresh popcorn. And they found that everybody ate almost the same amount, irrespective of whether it was stale or not. And when they were asked, there were people who said, yes, we realized it was stale, but that didn't stop them from eating it. Just the sound of people eating next to them, the smell of the popcorn, all of that triggered their own desire to eat. So if you're not mindful of these things, if you're not aware of these things, you're likely to be just sucked into that whole vortex. And I'm sure all of us know, when you go to a party and there's a whole lot of food and everybody's eating and everybody's excited, you tend to eat a little more, isn't it? So you just need to be conscious of it. I'm not saying don't eat or eat. It's not a judgment. It's not a judgment call. It's just that if you are more conscious and if you are aware and if you stop and ask yourself, is it really hunger? is my body really craving, is really requiring this particular food, or is it just, it's just that I'm addicted to it, sugar, for instance, right? So if you become conscious and aware of that, the likelihood of you being able to eat better, eat cleaner, eat healthier is much more. And in a similar way, Regina, if you talk about exercise, and you, I know, love exercise, and you exercise a lot as well. I know many people who exercise and who've been exercising for years, but they are constantly injuring themselves. They're constantly ending up with back pain and back injury, sprained ankles and sprained knees. And you wonder sometimes, is the body, if they've been exercising for so long, they should be stronger, they should be fitter. So why are they injuring themselves so often? I think it's perhaps that even while they're exercising, they are not being mindful of their exercise. They are not being conscious of which muscle are they using. Where are they putting pressure? Are they doing the exercise properly? And the body will send you signals saying this is not quite right. If you're performing an exercise incorrectly, for instance, your body will tell you there's something not quite right. If you do the deadlift incorrectly, your back is going to get, you know, be telling you long before it actually gives way. It actually tells you that it's, you're not doing something right. So even that is being mindful of your body and mindful of the signals that is sending, that the body is sending you minute by minute every day and all day. We are not conscious of these things. It's called body intelligence and body awareness. We are not conscious. We don't often think about how do you feel when you eat this particular food. You know, most, there are many people who are lactose intolerant, but they don't even realize that milk causes them bloating, for instance, right? Because they are so used to that wonderful South Indian coffee, you know, which I used to enjoy also. I used to love it. But it, I realized, you know, much later, I think I became lactose intolerant. And over the last 10 years, I recognized that there is bloating. There is, which is why I went off dairy and dairy products altogether. But many people don't even recognize that. They don't recognize that when they eat a lot of sweet, they feel very wired, or when they eat a very high carb meal, they feel very lethargic. They want to go to sleep. You know, there is this carb coma where you're really feeling sluggish. You don't even recognize those signals, right? Because we are not listening to our bodies. We are not observing our bodies. And these are all acts of mindlessness. And this is what leads to disease. Right? So if you have gastritis, if you have pain that keeps coming on, your body is telling you something. Your body is giving you the signals, and recognizing and paying attention to those signals that your body is sending you is really important if you want to participate in your own health, rather than rushing to the doctor every time you have a problem and just getting some pills across the table. Mm. Right? So you participate in your own health.
This is from my close friend Shama, you know, who we also stay in the same complex. So she actually is asking, you know, that not the scope of today's meeting, but I think some way you can connect that with mindfulness, it would be good. She's like, she wants to know how much sweet she can have, one thing. She is also actually one of the inspiration, because she, you know, like, she's super fit for her age, actually. And, you know, she does weight training. So what is that is being done wrong for bulking and training at that age, maybe 50 plus or something, some age of that thing? So is it okay to bulk up, you know, or is it okay to go ahead with a regular stream of regular planned activity? What is the best thing? I think this we can address at a later stage, but mindfulness, connecting with that body, if you can talk something about it, would be great.
Yeah. I mean, I think strength, you know, there is this whole concept of mind-body exercises. There are certain exercises that are considered mind-body, you know, like yoga, tai chi, qigong, all these come under the realm of mind-body. But honestly, in my opinion, I think all exercises are mind-body, or rather they have to be, particularly strength training. So if you are training and if you are working a particular muscle, your mind needs to be on that muscle that's being worked. which means your trainer or the person who's guiding you, ideally, or if you're training yourself, then you need to understand it, you need to study it a little bit. You need to understand which part of my body is supposed to feel the strain. And if you do that, you will also find that your entire workout is that much more effective. That's number one. And the whole, she asked the question about, can I exercise? Is that what she said?
She's exercising. It's more about the strength training, basically what you answered. Basically, they should know which muscle they are doing it, what level they can. You know, like after 60 years, you cannot just all on a sudden get into the gym and...
No, you can't. While you can exercise at any age, you need to know how to start and how to progress, because injury is very common with exercise. And the unfortunate thing is when you injure yourself, you're set back. You can't exercise for the next couple of weeks or even months if the injury is serious. So the objective of your exercise should not only be to lose weight. It should be to get fitter, which means that preventing injury should be top priority, which means, again, it requires a huge amount of mindfulness while you exercise. Even when you're doing a high intensity exercise where you know you are breathless and you're winded, but you still need to be very conscious of the positioning of your body, what you're doing right, if you're doing something wrong, because those are the times that you can injure yourself. You know, there are Regina, there are a lot of new exercises and exercise forms coming up. You know, you have Zumba, you have all kinds of things, right? So while all of them are, I mean, there's nothing wrong with them particularly, I think the problem is that many people get into it without really understanding their own bodies or paying attention to their own bodies. So they may imagine that they are doing it like the instructor who may be super fit and who may be doing it well, but they are not conscious of their bodies. They're not mindful of their bodies and end up injuring themselves. So that's the problem. So whatever you're doing, whether it's strength training, cardio, whatever it is you're doing, mindfulness is top priority.
I think, she has started at the right time. You know, she also, I remember her walking like 6-7 kilometers every day. Now, recently, she has fitness. Maybe I will, give your contact number so that she can a little more guidance on the scientific level. This is actually, one of these questions which we've already answered, the negative thoughts actually. Can mindfulness help in removing negative thoughts? This I would like to give a 2 minutes intro, because a lot of our people, especially women, 80% of the women in after 35, I should say, irrespective of whether they're working or not, have a lot of negative thoughts coming in their mind. You know, it could be just like that, am I giving enough time to my family because I'm busy with my career? Or is it that, okay, I spend all time with my family, but right now I don't have anybody to talk, or, because they're all busy, am I doing enough? Am I having an identity? A lot of such things are there actually. So how can, this is an important area to be addressed, because this is one of the reasons why many women, very smart women, become inefficient in life in multiple aspects, whereas their potential is just getting wasted. If that comes into the picture, the whole family gets so much better, the country gets better, the whole world gets better. I think that's something. I'm sure that this is the thing you can answer the best, because you're one.
No, it's actually one of my pet subjects too, Regina, because I too see this. Like what you said, there is huge potential, but the potential is limited because of one's own belief systems and one's own thoughts, etc. So when you talk about these negative thoughts, we need to question, where do these thoughts come from? And very often it is the belief system. For instance, if you come from a background or a belief system that says that women should not be working and you were not allowed to work, you were not encouraged to work, then perhaps you didn't. And you looked after your family for, 15 years. Now the children have gone away. And now you're questioning it and you're, second guessing yourself. But this whole concept of negative thoughts, why are you firstly judging the thought as being positive or negative? It's just a thought. Right? Don't pass judgment on your thought, because right there is where the anxiety sets in, because the minute you give it a label of negative and positive, it sets off this whole anxious train of thinking. So it's just a thought. It's a thought that's come into your mind that you haven't worked and you need to work, or maybe I should stop working. And then you take the next step forward. So what are you going to do about it? There's no point just sitting and thinking about it. What are you going to do about it? So if you haven't worked for so many years, and now maybe you do want to do something, children are not there, you do want to do something, you still could. And today the opportunities are a dime a dozen, especially with the internet. You know, you literally, your world's your oyster. Not everybody can get to the top of the ladder. Not everybody should get to the top of, you know, top of the corporate ladder or become the prime minister or the president. Or you don't need to do huge things. You can do small things which are equally satisfying, right? So the point is that I think that these kind of thoughts and questions and doubt, self-doubt, comes because there is also, people haven't really spent time understanding themselves and becoming aware of what their real needs are, becoming aware of what they consider their own life's purpose. Everybody has a purpose. So you need to find that purpose. It doesn't drop down. You know, it requires a lot of soul searching, a lot of pain during the process. And that's part of human existence. You will feel that, right? You can't escape that. So if you are having thoughts which are not so comfortable, that's quite normal. And that uncomfortable thought is just allowing you, or it's telling you, stop there and think about that thought. Think about the thought, like you said, you know, you meta thinking, you think about the thought. Obviously, the thought has entered your head because of something that's made you uncomfortable. Maybe you need to change your situation. Maybe you need to do a course. Maybe you need to go out and do some social work. Maybe you need to stop working so hard. Maybe you need to stop these unhealthy hours at night. So these thoughts, so-called negative thoughts, come into your mind for a reason. Instead of becoming anxious about them, instead of becoming depressed or pulled down by them, just stop and tell yourself that the thought has come in for a reason. It just requires me to stop, take a look at that thought, and then take a step forward in the right direction. And it may be in the wrong direction also, but that's also okay, right? Because all of us make mistakes. We can go down the wrong path, turn around and come back. That's fine too, right? But it is that journey that is important. It's that journey forward. Moving forward, that's what's important. Rather than just sinking into this depressive, tailspin, it's that step forward that's important. That's what I think. And I'm sure you'll agree, like you said, the potential is incredible. Most people are not using it. Women particularly.
And also, like, there is no age barrier for it. You know, any age.
Absolutely not. Absolutely not. I have a friend who is 73, and I was talking to her yesterday, and she said she's doing a course on one of these online forums, and you know, she's so engaged with it, she's so involved with it. And I was asking her, what do you want to do after that? And she said, well, I haven't really thought about that, but I want to complete this course, which will probably take me about 6 months, and then I will try and see what I can do with it. So I don't think age is a barrier at all. Definitely not.
It is not a barrier at all. And as you said, you know, once you are out of your comfort zone, your life begins.
But, yes.
That's a pain, but you need to go through that pain.
Yes.
You know?
Yes.
Stepping up step by step. Another question I have seen, this is a beautiful question that we will stop for today's, because we plan only 40 minutes. Dr. Sheila will come again, because this is her purpose in life. Create awareness.
Yes. Yes, yeah. That's my purpose. Yes, you're right.
So, Doc, this question is actually, it's a beautiful question anyway. You know, is it not being mindful is equivalent to not motivated? You know, that is the question. Not being mindful, is it equivalent to not being motivated?
No, I don't think so at all. You can be highly motivated and be completely mindless. or be completely mindful, either way.
Yes.
You know, I don't think the two are really connected. But what I would say is, if you are motivated and mindful, that would be a great combination. But I've seen various combinations, people who are highly motivated and driven, but completely mindless, completely. I mean, they're just, you know, doing things without thinking about it, and sometimes successful too.
Yeah.
You know, and because success, you know, is I mean, our world has a very strange, strange understanding of and definition of success, isn't it? So you know, gathering wealth, gathering name and fame, etc., is considered success. But have they done it mindfully? Have they done it? We don't know that. So I don't think the two are really connected. But what I would say is a combination is the best.
I think I can add one point, because I come across a lot of mid-level management guys highly successful by the time 40, 41. You know, they're highly motivated. The kind of thing they come in, okay, doc, can you reduce my cholesterol from this to this number? They work with numbers, okay. Highly motivated. In the first week, 2 weeks, 3 weeks, and a huge changes they bring in. But, you know, then I was like analyzing after some time, the motivation goes off and things like that. So what I was analyzing, then I understood that the motivation is only at the level of action of these career things. Actually, they're not focusing on themselves, actually, you know, their health. The motivation itself become very biased or very unidirectional when you're not mindful.
Yes, that's what. Yes. Yes, absolutely. I agree. It's also like if you take even weight, for instance, if you're obsessed with just the scale and you're not looking at, is your body improving? Is your fitness improving? Is your health improving? Is your brain improving? If you're not aware of those things, again, it's very unidirectional.
Okay, this is something about someone, you know, who just wrote, you know, someone was writing. See that a lot of these people goes through, especially youngsters go through a lot of pain related to relationship issues, even friends issues and things like that. So how to mindfully remove those emotional pain when they're kind of a scenario like this, you know, that is very relevant, right? Because you know, I feel that there's a lot of lacking of with respect to this aspect of life.
Relationships, yeah. Well, you and I know that, you know, in lifestyle medicine, we talk about social connectedness as one of the important pillars of lifestyle medicine. And human beings are social beings. I mean, it's just a part of our DNA. And while you're younger, I think we all go through some amount of pain in connection with relationships, because we may not be that adept at navigating and negotiating those relationships. The point is to learn from those experiences. I think pain is inevitable, an inevitable human experience. I don't think any of us, I mean, the Buddha says it, right? Pain is not optional, suffering is, right? So pain is a human experience, it is universal, but you don't need to suffer with it, which means you don't need to dwell on it. What you do need to do is you need to learn from it. And if you're smart, you will learn from it, and you will likely not make the same mistakes too many times. You may make it a couple of times, but you don't make it too many times. You learn to negotiate relationships. You learn the difference between authentic relationships and toxic relationships and ambivalent relationships. And you know that you learn that however much some toxic and ambivalent relationships may actually feel comfortable, which is very, very common. You know, when we're in a relationship that's not that comfortable, because of maybe it's been around for many, many years, there is a level of comfort. So it's difficult to walk away, or it's difficult to disengage. But understanding that these relationships can cause serious health issues, physical health issues, and of course, emotional issues, recognizing that, taking the right steps to disengage from such relationships, while at the same time creating authentic relationships, is extremely, extremely important for better health. And, you know, and before you, I mean, I know we're out of time. I must say that authentic relationships don't just happen. You have to put in the effort. Many times, you know, I've had people come and tell me, but I don't have any authentic friends. So you have to ask yourself, have you been an authentic friend?
True. You know, actually, that is true. Kind of, you know, started purposely investing in my relationship when my child was born, or, you know, relationship, not only my family thing, you know, definitely there will be misunderstandings and these things and all. But other than that, my friends and, you know, very close friends, you know, I made that very strong social connectedness with my close friends after my child was born. Otherwise, I was not much bothered about the social connectedness. I just focused on the work and worked tremendously in all walks of my relationship, all walks of life, actually. And also, like, she has asked something about detachment. You know, these questions, I would prefer we have another session, because it
because that's a huge topic by itself. It's a huge, and it's a very relevant topic too. You know, because it does cause a lot of suffering, a lot of pain, a lot of unnecessary pain. So I think we could probably do another one.
Yeah. Also, meanwhile, we will also kind of find out few of the mindfulness, which can be posted in our Instagram page, where you can practice. I do practice mindfulness every day, like 10 minutes in the morning, 10 minutes in the morning. One of them I follow is called Sarah Raymond, Mindful Moment. It's something which I love, you know, because, you know, the sound and a lot of...
Is it on YouTube?
It's on YouTube. Actually, they have a lot of videos, actually. A lot of videos.
Okay. There's something called Yoga Nidra also, Regina. It's very useful.
You know, my strategy had keep asking me to do that, actually. You know, like, I do that too. But this morning... helps me a lot. Even my daughter listens to it. She also has a little bit of irritability and things like that when things doesn't happen the way she
expects.
You know, that comes from the gene from the other side. So then I get very annoyed and irritated and this thing. So I ask her, you just go to the balcony, sit there and listen to this. 5 minutes, 10 minutes later, you won't believe. She comes very fresh and wanting to do so many
things. That's wonderful. Yeah.
I was thinking that also
Wonderful that you're able to guide her like that, isn't it? Instead of you getting agitated and as well and adding to the problem.
It's my experience, actually. My own experience with these emotions when initial phase of the was not doing it the way we expected. Then I kind of worked a lot on myself to improve my meta-thinking skills, productivity, multiplayers. Mindfulness helps a lot. But we need to be consistently practicing it. Many people practices, they say that no, I'm not able to do it. That's not right. You have to consistently practice it. You will find out what's your mindfulness. But sitting at one place and meditating may not be sometimes your mindfulness. Or cooking, you will have to find which one is giving you that kind of a focus on the present. That you have to find out and do it. Final concluding this thing, and then we can stop it, I think.
Yes, it's been a total joy talking to you, Regina. I just love your energy and your positivity and your complete authenticity. I think that's what comes across. And it's been a total joy talking to you. I hope we can have many sessions. And I'm going to call you on my Insta Live too, since this seems to be the done thing now.